Thanks everyone for being here. I'm honored and thrilled. You guys are my family. So it's nice to be here. We're still checking. You know what they say, mama's baby, daddy's maybe. Just a little aside, the date today, it is my birthday, but the date is 0110, which, as detectives in the Chicago Police Department know, is the uniform crime code by the FBI for homicide. So there. This is the city, Louisville, Kentucky, founded in 1778 by Colonel George Rogers Clark. This town on the falls of the Ohio is an important stopping off place for traders and settlers moving into the west. Louisville is a sprawling, thriving river port, part Midwestern, part backwoods, with a dash of Eastern commercialism and a touch of European elegance. Hogs roam the streets. Drays creak up to the wharf, where as many as 20 boats per day are bringing their wares. Businesses thrive. Factories, merchants, and wholesale grocers are doing a booming business, and workmen can get as much as $2 per day. Louisville is the county seat of Jefferson County, and it's the 10th largest city in the United States with a population of 68,000. In 1862, Kentucky is a divided state, and it tried to remain neutral in the Civil War, but ultimately sided with the Union. In September of 1862, Louisville is in a panic because of a Confederate invasion of the state. Business is at a standstill, and merchants are moving their wares across the Ohio River to Indiana for safety. Newly recruited soldiers from the north are pouring into the town, monopolizing all routes of travel. As Major General William Bull Nelson scrambles to defend the city with a ragtag force of militia and new recruits, he is not careful not to step on toes and bruise feelings. On September 29th, in the lobby of the Galt Hotel, that will change. General Nelson was basely murdered in cold blood by a disgruntled subordinate. That's where I come in. I carry a badge. The story you are about to hear is true. The events and characters are real people. No names or circumstances of the events have been changed. These are just the facts. My partner is Detective Keith Smith. My name is Girardi. At 7:30 a.m. on September 29th, 1862, in the Grand Hall of the Galt Hotel in Louisville, Kentucky, Brigadier General Jefferson Columbus Davis of the United States Army confronted Major General William Nelson, his superior, provoked a confrontation, and shot him at point-blank range with the revolver he borrowed from an accomplice. This event took place in full view of numerous witnesses, among whom were Senator John Crittenden of Kentucky and Indiana Governor Oliver P. Morton. Davis was immediately taken into custody, the weapon was recovered, and he fully admitted the deed to Captain Fry. General Nelson succumbed to his wounds within an hour of being shot. Now on your tables you have a summary, a major crimes incident report. This is the official major crimes incident report of the Chicago Police Department that my partner and I prepare every time we go out and handle one of our cases. On this you will find all the pertinent facts. Who, what, when, where, why, how, who's involved, what are the nature of the injuries, who the bad guy or the suspects are, witnesses, etc. Everything pertinent is on that sheet right there. We use this all the time. That's a summary of the investigation. Of course, this is a summarized form of that. There would be more detail, but that's exactly what we use every single day. Now, in order to make sense of what happened, we need to understand the circumstances surrounding it. In the summer of 1862, Kentucky and the Union are in a state of turmoil. Major General Don Carlos Buell, the commander of the Army of the Ohio, has allowed his Confederate opponents to steal a march on him and invade Kentucky. A two-pronged threat is endangering the state, whose loss, according to President Abraham Lincoln, would be tantamount to losing the whole game. Buell narrowly won a foot race to Nashville against Bragg, and is now trying to prevent the capture of Louisville and or Cincinnati. Buell is not a favorite with President Lincoln, with his army, or with the governors of the states of Indiana, Ohio, and Illinois, who have been lobbying strongly to have him removed from command. But Buell is oblivious to this criticism. He's a McClellan man all the way. He's old army. He has a disdain for the volunteer soldier. He is a pro-slavery general, and he's an advocate of soft war. That is, hurt your enemy, but don't hurt him too badly. Confederate General Braxton Bragg, on the other hand, is a favorite of his president, who's a good friend of his. But he's comparably not... He's not the favorite of his own men. However, he has something that Buell lacks, a killer instinct. He also has General William Kirby Smith cooperating with him, albeit keeping a distance so that he can maintain himself an independent command, because once they unite, Bragg will be the overall commander. The Confederates have launched a two-pronged attack into Kentucky, trying to regain control of the state. Buell had his army operating against Chattanooga, and he's literally out of position and off guard when the Confederates start their thrust. As the invasion in Kentucky unfolds, events elsewhere are threatening to destabilize the entire Union war effort. John Pope's Army of Virginia is soundly thrashed by Robert E. Lee at the Second Battle of Bull Run, and Lee seizes that opportunity to launch his invasion into Maryland. In the West, Earl Van Dorn has begun an invasion to operate against Corinth and try to recapture that vital railroad town. At the urging of the state governors of the Midwest, President Abraham Lincoln has called for 600,000 volunteers. Raw recruits from Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, Iowa, Ohio are being rushed to the defenses of Cincinnati and Louisville. Lincoln also uses the victory at Antietam to issue the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation, which is wildly unpopular with many of the soldiers and threatens perhaps the loss of the border states. Thus, there is a political as well as a military emergency unfolding in this late summer of 1862. The Confederate invasion of Kentucky rolls up like a juggernaut. Overwhelming victories are won at Richmond and Munfordville, and Bragg captures Bardstown and Frankfort and installs Richard Hawes as the Confederate governor of the state. Meantime, as Buell races north, he entrusts the safety of Louisville to Major General William Nelson and Cincinnati to Major General Horatio G. Wright, who's the commander of the Department of the Ohio. Both generals scramble to form piecemeal defenses. Much is at stake as the game unfolds in Kentucky. Now here we have a timeline which shows this avalanche of events in their close proximity to each other. Oftentimes when we look at the Civil War, we look at any campaign in a vacuum, but they're all related to things that are going on everywhere else. Things hundreds of miles away have a direct impact on what we're concerned with. Now, in any police investigation, it's critical that we do a timeline to pinpoint where people were at certain times in the sequence of events, because sometimes it becomes very, very important at trial or during the course of the investigation to break an alibi or to show some other important fact. This is a little bit different from that, but the concept is exactly the same. We'll talk about our victim. William Nelson was a native of Kentucky. Born September 27, 1824 in Maysville, he attended Maysville Academy and was a student at Norwich University at the age of 13, like many of today's college kids. When he was 16, he received an appointment as midshipman in the Navy by his congressman and became a career Navy man, a veteran of the Mexican War, rising to the rank of commander at the outbreak of the Civil War. Nelson was a giant of a man, 6'4", over 300 pounds, with a fiery temper. He was legendary in his profanity. Kind of makes you wonder, doesn't it? He was a man of many accomplishments. He was a good friend, but a tyrant to his enemies or to those he viewed as inefficient. His nickname of Bull was well earned. Because of his Kentucky origins and his loyalty to the Union, At the start of the Civil War, he was sent to Kentucky to ascertain the loyalty of the state. And he was authorized by Lincoln to arm loyal Kentuckians and was instrumental in the smuggling of 5,000 muskets into Kentucky, with which he armed Kentucky loyalists. And then he founded Camp Dick Robinson and started recruiting and training these soldiers in violation of Kentucky's so-called neutrality. He was quickly... He was quickly rewarded with a commission as Brigadier General, and he distinguished himself in combat in several small battles. His division was the first into Nashville after the capture of Fort Donelson, and thus Nelson captured the first Confederate capital to fall to the Union. And it was his division that came to the relief of Grant after the first day of Shiloh, according to some, saving Grant's headquarters. After Shiloh, he was promoted to Major General, and he was slated for corps command in Buell's Army of the Ohio. Buell had few more capable subordinates than Bull Nelson, and Nelson was available for the Louisville assignment because he had been wounded in the Battle of Richmond on August 30th. Now he was being entrusted with the defense of the city of Louisville, his task to hold the city until Buell could march to its relief. Nelson had little to work with except local militia and the raw recruits coming from the Midwest. He had little faith in the new recruits because he had seen them run at Richmond. Nelson was given the command of the Louisville defenses on September 14th, just 2 weeks after he was wounded. He quickly began improving the city's fortifications and restricted river traffic and the use of all bridges. He alarmed the citizens by stating that he would burn the city down before he would surrender it to the Confederates, and he put the city under martial law. He began organizing the raw regiments that he was receiving from the north into brigades and divisions, and he was only too glad to accept whatever help he could get this job done. When Horatio G. Wright, who was engaged in similar activities at Cincinnati, sent him Jefferson C. Davis, a veteran division commander, to be his subordinate, Nelson was gratified, both because he was getting a professional and because he knew, liked, and respected Jefferson C. Davis. He knew him from Charleston before the war, and he knew him from the Corinth campaign earlier in 1862. Nelson gave Davis the important job of organizing these new regiments into brigades and divisions for the defense of the city, a job that Davis felt was beneath him. On September 22nd, Nelson issued an order directing all women and children to be prepared to leave the city. And he restricted the use of the Jefferson Ferry, so he was creating a traffic jam trying to get these people out of town, but at the same time keeping the military routes open. Indiana Governor Oliver B. Morton was coming into town, as he often did, to look after his own troops. But Nelson was hearing from his staff that instead of taking an active role in organizing these brigades and divisions, Jefferson C. Davis was spending the last 4 days especially in his hotel room, sitting on the heaters, taking care of his health, and not paying any attention whatsoever to the job he was entrusted with. Furthermore, he was being openly critical of Nelson's efforts. Later that day, Nelson summoned Davis to his headquarters at the north end of the West Corridor on the first floor of Louisville's Galt House Hotel for a status report. The meeting that followed was to prove very important in the careers of both men. The meeting between the two generals took place in Nelson's room. Nelson saw Davis and he said, "Well, General Davis, how's it going? How many regiments have you got?" Nelson says, "I don't know." "How many men do you have?" "Well, I don't know. About 2,500, but they don't have any muskets." And Nelson throws up his hands and says, "What? What do you mean you don't know? I gave you this job because you're a professional soldier. And I find out that I made a mistake by entrusting you with this? How dare you tell me you don't know?" And Davis says, "Well, I'm a professional soldier. You can't talk to me like that. How dare I demand you treat me with the respect I deserve. And if you're going to talk to me like that, I want a witness." So Nelson opens the door and summons in some of his staff. And he says, "General Davis, how many men do you have?" And Davis says, I told you, about 2,500. And Nelson says, about 2,500? God damn you, sir! Don't you know that when I ask you for a number, I expect a specific answer? And Davis says, well, I told you, I don't know how many men I have. I just came here to find out if there were arms for them. And you can't talk to me this way. You have no authority over me. And Nelson says, by God, I have a mind to put you under arrest, sir, and put you out of this city. And Davis says, you have no authority over me. You're not the boss of me. You can't tell me what to do. And Nelson says, God damn you, sir. Get out. I have a mind to place you under arrest. You're relieved of command, sir. And Davis says, I won't go. And Nelson turns to his staff and he says, if General Davis is not out of the city by 9 p.m. tonight, take him and put him across the Ohio River by force. Davis left. Bull Nelson did not like Indiana nor anybody from Indiana. Hoosiers were, according to Nelson, the uncouth descendants of poor trash from the mountains of Kentucky, Tennessee, and North Carolina. Who's here from Indiana? He even disparaged his own brother Tom, whom he said lost all his good manners when he moved to Indiana. His brother had the audacity to put his feet up on the mantle. How's your mantle?
No Spurs cars.
At Richmond, Kentucky, on August 30th, raw Indiana recruits were routed after their commander, Indiana General Malin Manson, disobeyed orders. 7,000 new recruits were routed and captured. Trying to rally the troops, Nelson was wounded. He was shot twice in the leg. He later accused Manson of, officially he made an accusation, he accused Manson of stupidity, disobedience of orders, and responsibility for the loss of 7 Indiana regiments. Nelson also cashiered another Indiana officer, Colonel Ebenezer Dumont, who surrendered the important supply depot at Lebanon Junction to Kirby Smith. A similar disaster occurred at Munfordville, where untried Colonel John T. Wilder surrendered that important post to Braxton Bragg, resulting in the loss of the Green River Bridge, an important Louisville-Nashville Railroad bridge, and the loss of that bridge kept the railroad out of commission for several months. Nelson was also aware of the fall from grace of General Lew Wallace, another Indiana general who was blamed for the near disaster to Grant at Shiloh, which Nelson took credit for saving and overturning that disaster. So when Nelson found out that Lew Wallace, who was in disrepute after the Battle of Shiloh, had nothing to do, responded to the emergency in Kentucky by reporting to General Horatio Wright, who sent him to Lexington to take charge of the defenses of Lexington. When Wallace got to Lexington, he found General Jeremiah Boyle there. Boyle had previously been the department commander. Wright supplanted Boyle. Boyle was junior in rank to Wallace, but Wallace willingly and voluntarily subordinated himself to Jerry Boyle. When Nelson found out, he relieved Wallace and sent him back to Cincinnati, much to Wallace's relief. And this is what Wallace said about it. It may be doubted if Nelson had ever read Chesterfield on the social amenities. Nelson had aroused the ire of Indiana's governor, Oliver P. Morton, by all of these actions and attitudes against Indiana's generals. And Morton was not necessarily a fan of Nelson. He reinstated Generals Manson and Colonel Dumont, and he was lobbying for the relief of Nelson also. He was a constant irritant to Nelson during this emergency. Now Nelson had another reason to despise Indianans: Jefferson Columbus Davis, another useless Indiana general. Here's our offender. In Chicago, we have offenders. Perpetrators you have on television in a faraway place called New York. If you use the word perpetrator to a Chicago policeman, he will laugh at you. The official term is offender, or the much more scientific term, bad guy. Listen to the police scanners if you don't believe me. Major General Jefferson Columbus Davis was a native of Indiana, born March 2, 1828. He was a volunteer in the 3rd Indiana during the Mexican War, and he so impressed his superiors that he was directly commissioned lieutenant into an artillery regiment after the war. In fact, he tried to get into West Point, but his congressman had already nominated somebody else. So instead, they just directly commissioned him. He served with distinction in the pre-war army, and he was in the garrison at Fort Sumter on April 12th when the Confederates opened fire. He was promoted to colonel, and he led the 22nd Indiana at the Battle of Wilson's Creek. He was promoted to brigadier general in December of 1861, and he led a division in the Army of the Southwest fighting in the Battle of Pea Ridge and during the 1862 Corinth campaign. But he got sick like everybody else in that army did, and he went back to Indiana on sick leave over the summer. Because of the Kentucky crisis, he rose from his sick bed and offered his services to General Horatio Wright at Cincinnati, and aware of the need at Louisville, Wright sent him to report to General Nelson. Physically, Davis was 5'7" and 125 pounds. Although generally quiet in demeanor, he was described as being capable of being aggressive, feisty, and confrontational, with a fiery and combative spirit. He was also reputedly, and this is why he and Nelson had some trouble, as the most talented swearer in the entire federal army. Davis resented the subordinate role that he was given by Nelson, and even his biographers admit that he took lukewarm interest in the duties he was assigned, which was unforgivable during this emergency. After being relieved by Nelson, a furious Davis crossed the river at Jeffersonville. He was accompanied by Brigadier General Stephen Burbridge, whom Nelson had also relieved from command. That's good. These two disgruntled guys with a beef on their commander traveling together. Be a fly on that wall. Davis reported to General Wright in Cincinnati, who tried to calm his temper. During the week between his arrival in Cincinnati and the events that we're going to talk about in a moment, he had a week to either cool off or let his temper simmer. During this period of time, he decided to contact Indiana's governor, Oliver P. Morton, and traveled to Indianapolis, where he met with Morton at Morton's home. What they discussed is not on record. In any event, he had a week to cool off. On September 25th, the Army of the Ohio marched into Louisville, thereby relieving the emergency to some extent. Buell took his headquarters at the Galt House. Now, there's no record that he was aware of the falling out between Nelson and Davis, but if he was, he more than likely would have sided with Nelson. Nelson was his go-to guy. Meantime, General Davis received permission from Horatio Wright at Cincinnati to report to Buell at Louisville, presumably to take over command of his division. But upon arrival at Louisville on September 28th, Davis did not report to General Buell. Instead, he went to visit his division at Beargrass Creek, a few miles outside of town, and he spent the day with them, arriving at the Galt House Hotel too late in the evening to call upon General Buell. Now, this is a violation of military protocol, but, you know, maybe you can forgive the guy for being away from his division for a while. Now, according to an unsubstantiated report, which was revealed 40 years after the fact, Colonel Walter Whitaker of the 6th Kentucky Infantry supposedly overheard a group of Indiana officers conspiring to provoke Nelson into a confrontation, after which one of them would shoot him. Colonel Whitaker reported this to a Lieutenant Ellis, who was a member of Nelson's staff, but Ellis claimed that he didn't find any credence in this report, and so he didn't bother to tell anybody about it. Well, if a witness comes to tell me about a murder 40-something years after the fact, I don't put any credence in the report either, nor do I in this one. In my professional opinion, it's hogwash. This is a perfect example of one of those things where the further back in time something happened, the much more clearly I remember it. Let's go to the scene of the crime. The Galt House, which in the early 19th century was the residence of Dr. W.C. Galt. In 1834, the Galt House Hotel was established, and in 1835 it was opened as a 60-room hotel on the northeast corner of 2nd and Main Streets. During the 19th century, the Galt House was acclaimed as Louisville's best hotel. Every dignitary and who that came to Louisville wanted to stay at the Galt House. It was a luxury hotel within sight of the Ohio River, and it was a favorite haunt for dignitaries and military brass. On the morning of September 29th, instead of going directly to report to Buell, Davis may have had an excuse the night before, it's too late, maybe Buell was in bed, but early in the morning, Buell was certainly in his office and ready to attend to business. But instead of reporting to him first thing for orders, Davis goes to breakfast with Governor Morton and a whole entourage. Now, Nelson had just finished his own breakfast, and he was at the front desk in the lobby of the hotel when Davis, accompanied by Governor Morton, approached him. In addition to Governor Morton, also present were Captain Thomas W. Gibson, Henry Villard, a reporter for the New York Tribune, who happened to be a personal friend of Abraham Lincoln. He was one of the guys on that inaugural train ride. And Alf Burnett, a Cincinnati newspaper reporter. Witnessing the event were Senator John Crittenden of Kentucky and Galt House proprietor Silas Miller. Buell's Chief of Staff, Captain James Fry, and Brigadier General T.L. Crittenden, and a host of other officers were either in the room or immediately at hand. In front of this audience, Davis walks up to General Nelson, accompanied, shadowed by Governor Morton, and walks up to him and says, "General Nelson, I resent the way you insulted me last week, and I demand an apology from you." Nelson, who is a little bit hard of hearing, probably from action under quarterdeck, looks at him and says, "What? What did you say? Do you know who you're talking to?" And Davis says, "You're Bill Nelson." Nelson looks at him and says, "Get away from me, you damn puppy. I don't want anything to do with you." Davis reaches up for a calling card on the desk of the hotel and flings it into Nelson's face. Nelson, being the mild-mannered, genteel soul that he was, backhands Davis, sends him staggering, and says, "I don't want anything to do with you." Now, Davis raises a fist. And you can imagine, this is David and Goliath here. And Nelson looks at him and laughs and says, "Get away from me, you cowardly son of a bitch." And he gives him a bitch slap. That's official police lingo. And he turns his back and walks away. Now, put yourself in Jeff Davis's shoes. He just called out his boss. His boss has slapped him and called him a coward and now walked away from him. Now what do I do? So what he says is, "You haven't heard the last of this." And Davis says, turns to his friend and says, "Give me a pistol." His friend, Governor Morton is there, and before he walks away, Nelson looks at the governor and says, "Did you come here too to see me insulted?" And Morton says, "Well, no, I'm just here with my friend. You know, I'm a witness. I didn't know anything like this was going to happen. I'm just an innocent politician. I didn't know anything was going to happen." Nelson stalks off. Davis says, "Give me a gun." And Captain Thomas Gibson turns to him, pulls a pistol out, and hands it to Davis. He says, "I always carry the article. It's a tranter. Works light." Davis takes the pistol and now goes after Nelson. He calls out to him. Nelson turns around near the staircase. Presumably he was on his way up to either go to his room to get away from this or to go report to Buell that we had a problem with this idiot downstairs. When he turns around, Davis says, "Prepare to defend yourself," pulls the pistol, and fires a shot at point-blank range, hitting General Nelson just above the heart on the left side of his chest. The wounded Nelson staggers, but walked up the stairs and collapsed on the landing. Nelson had a single gunshot wound. Now present and a witness to some of this was Alf Burnett, the Cincinnati reporter for the Morning Leader. And this is what he wrote. Now Burnett missed the initial confrontation between Davis and Nelson. He comes out right after the slap. And this is what he wrote. "Just at this juncture, I entered the office. the people congregated there were giving Nelson a wide berth. Recognizing the general, I said, "Good morning, General." At this time, I was not aware of what had previously passed. His reply to me was, "Did you hear that damned insolent scoundrel insult me, sir? I suppose he don't know me, sir. I'll teach him a lesson, sir." During the time, he was retiring slowly toward the door leading to the ladies' sitting room. At this moment, I heard General Davis ask for a weapon, first of a gentleman who was standing near him, and then meeting Captain Gibson, who was just about to enter the dining room. He asked him if he had a pistol. Captain Gibson replied, "I always carry the article," and handed one to him, remarking as Davis walked toward Nelson, "It is a tranter trigger. Works light." Nelson by this time had reached the hall and was evidently getting out of the way to avoid further difficulty. Davis's face was livid, and such a look of mingled indignation, mortification, and determination I never before beheld. His hand was slowly raised, and as Nelson advanced, Davis uttered the one word, "Halt," and fired. Now, despite the various witness accounts of this investigation, there's not much of a mystery here for anybody with a clue. And based on my own 22 years of experience as a Chicago homicide detective, I stand here to tell you that I suspect General Davis in the lobby with the revolver. And here's the revolver. The murder weapon was a Tranter revolver, which was owned by Captain Thomas W. Gibson, who was a personal friend of Davis. The Tranter is a double-action cap and ball pistol invented around 1856 by an Englishman coincidentally named Tranter. Originally, this gun operated with a special dual-trigger mechanism. If you notice, there's no hammer on the gun. The lower trigger, if you pull that, puts the gun at half-cock, and then the upper trigger is a hair trigger. If you pull them both simultaneously, you can fire the gun double action. Now, we don't know if the gun was cocked or not when Gibson gave it to Davis. It doesn't really matter. And just as an aside, today I was lucky enough in the mail, finally, to get this to show up. Here is a picture. Now, that gun there belongs to Gail Pewitt. He lent me the picture for this program. But this is the actual gun. It's in the hands of the family in Virginia, in Goochland, Virginia. This is the actual gun. It's still around. Henry Villard, the reporter for the New York Tribune, was present, and this is what he said. "I was just finishing breakfast in the dining room on the ground floor when I heard the sound of a shot coming from the large entrance hall directly in front. I hurried out and learned to my horror that General Jefferson C. Davis had shot General Nelson with a revolver. General William B. Hazen wrote, "I was in the hotel office when Nelson was shot. Hurrying toward the stairs where the firing took place, I met Davis, whom I had never seen before. He was in his shirt sleeves, without a hat, and greatly agitated. I at once seized him. He told me who he was, and I released him." Upon hearing the shot, General T.L. Crittenden ran out of the dining room. His father, the senator, called out, "General Davis has just shot General Nelson." Crittenden ran up the stairs to the side of his fallen friend, who had been placed on the floor. "Nelson, are you seriously hurt?" he asked. "Tom, I am murdered," was Nelson's reply. The wounded Nelson was carried to the room of Lieutenant Colonel Thomas C. James. Carrying the general were John Allen Crittenden, the senator's nephew, Lieutenant A.N. Ellis, the guy with the bogus conspiracy claim, and Colonel George T. Cotton. Nelson's friends, Tom Crittenden and James Fry, came to the room to monitor the condition. Nelson asked Silas Miller, the hotel's proprietor, to call for a minister. "Send for a clergyman. I wish to be baptized. I have been basely murdered." Dr. Jeremiah J. Talbot was summoned to the room. The mortally wounded general spent his last moments being baptized and asking God for forgiveness. Dr. D.C. Cummings, Nelson's medical director, gave immediate treatment to the general, but Buell's chief surgeon, Dr. Robert Murray, was also summoned to the room. When Murray arrived, Nelson had already lost consciousness, and this is what Dr. Murray wrote. "I found him on the floor of his room, insensible, with stertorous breathing, and evidently dying from hemorrhage. The ball, a small one, entered just above the heart, had passed through that organ or the large vessels connected with it. I am quite sure that he did not utter an intelligible word after I saw him. Murray pronounced Nelson dead at 8:30 a.m. Captain James Fry was friend to both Davis and Nelson. In fact, he served in the same artillery unit with Davis, and Davis actually outranked him in that unit before the war. He also happened to be Buell's chief of staff. After witnessing the shooting and seeing Nelson's condition, Fry and Adjutant William H. Spencer took Davis into custody in the name of General Buell. They disarmed him and locked him in his room on an upper floor of the Galt House. Davis told Fry that he wanted to relate the facts while they were still fresh in his mind. Davis freely admitted to Fry that he had shot Nelson. He said he did not come to the hotel to commit murder, but he fully intended to force an apology, or lacking that, a confrontation forcing Nelson to respond. Davis said that when Nelson slapped him, after Davis had thrown the crumpled card into Nelson's face, Honor demanded that he retaliate. He claimed that he obtained a pistol, and it went off. Don't you hate when that happens? Every policeman knows that nobody ever shoots somebody on purpose. The gun goes off. I didn't know it was loaded. I was only trying to scare him. It malfunctioned. Well, that's Jesse Davis's claim to fame. Davis was kept under close confinement in his hotel room at the Galt House, but he was allowed visitors and some freedom of movement. Now, he tried to justify his actions to his personal staff, Colonel Henry Daly, T.W. Morrison, and J.B. Merriweather. And to this friendly audience, Davis claimed that when he fired the shot, he thought that Nelson was going to get a gun if he didn't already have one. I had to do it. I belong to the regular army, and not to resent an insult of that kind would have been to make me shunned by all my brother officers. I must either call him to account or be as the dog that sleeps under my father's floor. I regret the necessity, but could not have done otherwise. Well, this is a little different than what he told Captain Fry, isn't it? There's a little differentiation in the story here. Now, this is indicative of what happens when a homicide offender or any bad guy starts to talk. Right after the fact, they tell you the truth. Then they start to think. And when bad guys start to think, policemen gain the advantage. Because now they better have one hell of a good memory. And everything that they say better be consistent with everything they said before. Because otherwise you pick apart their stories and either they end up confessing or they end up asking for Kirk Carlson. or Bob Stoller there. He's more of that ilk. With the emphasis on ilk.
He's not an ilk. He's not an ilk.
Is that when you plant the story then?
Jefferson Davis remained in close arrest in his room at the Galt House awaiting a decision as to his fate. His division remained under the command of General Robert Mitchell during this period. Now, during the period of confinement, Davis wrote to Horatio Wright, "Since my arrest, I have confined myself strictly," everybody at Cook County Jail is confining themselves, "strictly to my room, and find my health is somewhat failing by it." Poor Davis. Davis was remanded to civilian authorities on October 1st when the army marched away. But no civilian charges were brought against him because it was understood he would be tried by court-martial. The confusion is attributed to, quote, intervention of some sort. No formal military charges were ever brought against Davis. Now, oddly enough, nobody detained, arrested, or tried to charge Thomas W. Gibson for his part in the murder. While it is pure unsubstantiated speculation that Davis's companions had conspired to kill Nelson, there is not even a reasonable doubt that it was Gibson who provided Davis with the murder weapon. Gibson was Davis's friend, his mentor, his commander in the unit in the Mexican War. A little bit about Gibson. He attended West Point, but he was expelled because he committed an arson after disabling the firefighting equipment. After his expulsion from West Point, he joined the United States Navy, and he was court-martialed and forced to leave the Navy because he had a propensity for dueling. So having proved his character and his lack of qualifications for anything else, he took the job that he proved most that he was eminently qualified for. He became an attorney. Gibson became a prominent Louisville attorney, and he was also the captain of the Louisville Home Guard. Now, the fact that Davis had to get a gun. Now, if this confrontation takes place, and I get into an argument with this man, and I throw something in his face, and he slaps me, and I have my gun, I pull it out and shoot him, that's involuntary manslaughter, maybe second-degree murder. We got a first-degree murder here. That's not what happened. Davis is the aggressor. He starts this confrontation. He gets mad when he loses. He goes somewhere else to get a gun. He gives me the gun, being a lawyer and always carrying one with him. I take the gun and go after this man who is retreating. He's leaving the room. I call him out. He turns around, and I don't wait. I just shoot him. I execute him. Now, you'll see in the articles, the assassination. This is not an assassination. This is a first-degree murder. My partner and I are going out tonight to go solve this thing. Thank God it's like a Chicago murder, and we don't have to do a whole lot to figure it out. But that's the difference. That's what makes this a first-degree murder, those separate acts. The difference between reacting and going and taking separate steps to acquire a pistol from somebody and then taking that gun and committing the act, those steps make it a first-degree murder. On September 29th, Gibson wrote in his diary, and this is where we lose the reasonable doubt, "This morning, Jeff C. Davis killed Nelson with my trencher pistol. I knew Nelson well, and socially, I liked him. But he deserved his fate." And the verdict of the community is unanimous. Davis was right. Davis is under military arrest at the Galt House. Now, after reading some of the newspaper accounts, this is what Gibson wrote in his diary. "The language used by Nelson was much more violent and insulting than it is represented to have been. When Nelson met Davis, when Davis met Nelson, he ordered him to halt twice, but Nelson continued to advance, placing his hand behind him when Davis fired. I think Nelson was intending returning to his room to get up a quarrel with Governor Morton when Davis met him." Many people weren't sure what happened because there were all various accounts, different people saw different things, and there were rumors flying everywhere. And this is why in any investigation, you take the witnesses and you separate them. And you talk to them one-on-one. You don't want this witness to say something in front of that witness, and now she remembers something she didn't see because he planted the seed in her mind. You want to separate all this stuff out. Now, to show you how diverse these rumors are, Phil Sheridan, who was never a friend of the truth, heard that it was Nelson who had shot Davis. But like I said, Sheridan rarely got the facts right. In the aftermath of the shooting, General James S. Jackson and General William R. Terrell gathered in front of the Galt House, and they demanded that Davis be hanged on the spot. And they created such a disturbance that detachment of the 85th Illinois was called to take up guard around the Galt House, and the rest of the army was confined to camp. Jackson and Terrell vowed revenge upon Davis, but both of them were killed the next week in the Battle of Perryville. Brigadier General Jerry Boyle, another Kentucky general, accused Governor Morton of complicity in the murder, and when he spied him in the hotel, he confronted him and punched him in the nose. If anybody envied Bull Nelson on September 29th, it was Don Carlos Buell. Not only had he just lost his most trusted corps commander, he lost one of his most veteran division commanders who was in custody for killing his corps commander. To add to his woes, at 9 o'clock in the morning, a Colonel J.C. McKibben came up to him and handed him a dispatch relieving him of command of the Army of the Ohio and ordering him to turn it over to General George Thomas. Now, most of the rest of the day was wasted as dispatches flew back and forth because Thomas refused to take the command because of the emergency and the fact they were in a campaign. And Halleck was being Halleck and saying, well, I didn't really think McKinnon was going to deliver the order, so you can suspend it for now. And Buell was saying, well, I'm ready to go to Indianapolis anytime I can get a train ticket. And at the end of the day, Buell was put back in temporary command of the Army. In the meantime, no formal charges were placed against Davis. No investigation was conducted. Nobody sequestered and interviewed or took statements from the various witnesses. Nobody secured a crime scene. Nobody looked for any other kind of evidence. Nobody did anything that even an incompetent policeman would do. They just dropped the ball. Now, September 30th was devoted to Nelson's funeral. Buell only issued an order stating that Nelson had been killed and that the Army was taking a day off to honor him. It was not until October 3rd, as the Army was marching en route to what would be the Battle of Perryville, that Buell finally telegraphed Washington, informing them that Davis was under arrest for the murder of Nelson and requesting that he be tried by court-martial in Washington because he was too busy finally fighting the war to take care of matters like this. Buell later wrote that nothing but the law of violence could under any circumstances justify the manner of the killing for the alleged provocation, and no mere merit of ordinary soldiership could atone for the sacrilege against discipline under the circumstances which existed. Buell accused Governor Morton of intervening on behalf of Davis, as he had always interfered with Buell's authority by his protection of Indiana troops. The dignity of a state was abused by the attitude of its governor in this affair, and the authority of the general government was even more degraded by its condonement of the act, a condonement made virtually, if not actually, at his, Governor Morton's, direction. Nelson's body lay in state at the Galt House until 3 p.m. on September 30th, after which he was moved to the church. He was furnished with an elegant rosewood coffin mounted with silver, and draped across it was the division flag that his troops had carried at the Battle of Shiloh. Amid the solemn tolling of church bells, the funeral procession moved to the Calvary Episcopal Church. Nelson's sword was placed across the flag-draped coffin, and which was adorned with bouquets of flowers. The hearse was pulled by four white horses. The casket was carried by Generals T.L. Crittenden, Gordon Granger, Alexander McCook, Richard Johnson, and James S. Jackson, kind of a who's who of the Army of the Ohio's High Command. The Reverends Newell and Lang read the Episcopal burial service, and then Reverend Talbot delivered the eulogy. The general is dead. Let us remember his virtues and emulate them. Let us forget his faults and bury them. After the ceremony, Nelson's body was moved to the cemetery, escorted by Lieutenant Colonel Nicholas Anderson of the 6th Ohio and two companies each of the 2nd and 6th Ohio Infantry. The general's gray horse walked behind the hearse with his boots reversed in the stirrups, and they were followed by a cavalry company and two pieces of artillery, all marching to the sound of a muffled drum. Now, reaction to the murder was mixed. John Pope, who despised Nelson, wrote, "The only surprise felt by those who knew him was that some such fate had not befallen him before. He was the most tyrannical, arrogant, and abusive officer that I ever saw. He did not appear to make any effort to control his violent temper. It was impossible that he could have long avoided a violent end at the hands of some of the victims of his wrath." William B. Hazen, Nelson's friend, wrote this, I knew him only as a kind and genial gentleman. As a soldier, he was vigilant and painstaking to the last degree. No man could be braver, more just to those he thought meritorious, or more severe with every manner of dereliction, but at times he was very harsh and petulant. William T. Sherman wrote in a letter to his wife, "What a sad thing was Nelson's fate. He was a clever fellow, but overbearing and blustering. Davis, on the contrary, was a modest, bashful, quiet, but brave man. I cannot justify the act, but do not condemn it." William P. Carlin wrote, "He, Nelson, was a man of great power over men, active, aggressive, and intelligent. He had the reputation of being overbearing and rough in his treatment towards subordinates, except in battle, when he was amiable and kind towards all. His death was a positive loss to the Union cause in Kentucky." And Richard Johnson wrote, "I knew Nelson well. He was a man of energy, nerve, and ability, and his loss was a severe blow to our army, as true and tried men were scarce in the bleak, dark days of the rebellion. Opinions among the rank and file varied, too. Members of the 6th Kentucky made a pledge to kill Jeff Davis on sight. But members of the 8th Kentucky were glad that, quote, a tyrant of the 1st Water had been killed. When they heard the news, the rank and file of 105th Ohio broke out in cheers. Captain E.A. Wilson of the 10th Illinois wrote, for one man to kill another in cold blood is a serious, sad thing to do. But in the case of killing General Nelson, it was regarded by the Army generally as justifiable. The verdict of the Army and the nation was, serve them right. R.V. Marshall of the 22nd Indiana stated, every man in the 22nd deeply sympathized with General Davis and believed him fully justified in the course he pursued. In his diary, Daniel Howe of the 79th Indiana wrote, General Nelson shot by J.C. Davis at the Galt House. Great rejoicing among soldiers and civilians. But Levi Ross, one of Nelson's men, wrote, quote, the provocation was trivial and without the shadow of justice. The cynical Ross predicted the future, however. Davis will probably go free, unwhipped of justice, because he wears a star. The Battle of Perryville was fought on October 8th without Nelson and Davis. Although the Federals won, it was a badly managed battle. Bragg was able to retreat to safety, and Buell came under another deluge of criticism. Davis was released from custody on October 13th. Interestingly, on October 18th, the correspondent of the Cleveland Morning Leader wrote, By the by, General Jefferson C. Davis is at the Galt House, and if under arrest, is not guarded. It is impossible to learn anything about the matter, as for some reason or other, the people here studiously avoid talk upon the subject. Why this is, I know not. After 2 weeks of duty in the defenses of Cincinnati, Davis was restored to command of his division on October 21st. A variety of circumstances led to his release. First, the failure to bring formal charges. Under the Articles of War, formal charges must be brought within 8 days. This was not done. General Horatio G. Wright was instrumental in this breakdown. It was he who ordered Davis' release from custody. Wright justified the release based on the fact that the charges hadn't been officially filed. Furthermore, he claimed that Davis had acted in self-defense and that Buell shared this view. This was patently untrue, but Wright was the local commander, and this is what he wrote. I was satisfied that Davis acted purely on the defensive in this unfortunate affair, and I presume that Buell held very similar views, as he took no action in the matter after placing him in arrest. Wright was a crony of Davis and deliberately distorted the facts. Don Carlos Buell had notified Washington, D.C. that he wanted Davis tried by court-martial, and he requested that that trial be held in Washington, as the emergency in Kentucky prevented him from holding court. This can be construed as an intent to bring charges, but the charges weren't officially filed. Now, this is an argument for lawyers to argue out, not for people on the front lines to do. Buell never followed up on the charges because after Perryville, he was relieved from command. As for the self-defense argument, many people felt Davis was justified for responding to an insult, but nobody ever suggested that he acted in self-defense. Nelson was wronged by Wright. General Richard Johnson wrote, though Davis was aggrieved, it is difficult to see how he can be justified in provoking the final quarrel and committing the foul deed of death. The facts will not sustain the theory of self-defense, and the military law, as he well knew, offered prompt and ample redress for all the wrong Nelson had done him at their first meeting. But he made no appeal to law. On the contrary, he deliberately took all law into his own hands. Another reason, perhaps, was the personal and direct interference of Governor Oliver Hazard Perry Throckmorton, called by some the Deputy President of the West. He vigorously guarded all of Indiana's officers from all critics, like a godfather. Morton was one of the staunchest of the war governors, called by his detractors a dictator and an underhanded mobster. He was aggressive, violent, unscrupulous, prejudiced, and utterly unyielding. He was radically and violently pro-union, and he was a fanatical abolitionist. During Indiana's internal turmoil in 1862, he disbanded the General Assembly, called out the state militia, and borrowed money from the federal government to pay the state debt. Morton regarded Kentucky's governors, first Beriah Magoffin and later Dick Robinson, as traitors. And as a result, he constantly meddled in Kentucky's affairs. And actually, there's rumors that he bragged that he was the governor of Indiana and Kentucky. Morton detested Don Carlos Buell, and he felt he was not conducting the war as it should be fought. He constantly lobbied to have Buell removed in favor of someone who would fight. Immediately after the murder, Morton visited Lincoln at the White House and had several private audiences with him. Morton claimed the trip was in reference to issues dealing with Indiana's prisoners of war. Perhaps this was an inside joke, as right now, Davis was a POW. It is not known what transpired in the several meetings between Lincoln and Morton. Lincoln knew about the murder because John Crittenden had telegraphed him from the Galt House the day it happened. Lincoln valued Nelson and lamented his loss. Nelson had been instrumental in saving Kentucky for the Union in 1861, but Lincoln needed to save Kentucky in 1862, and Nelson was dead, and no one could bring him back. Lincoln is not known to have directly interfered, but during his visit, Governor Morton made a rousing speech in favor of the Emancipation Proclamation, and before leaving Washington, Davis retained James Speed, a personal friend of Lincoln's, as his attorney. Before leaving Washington, Morton took the opportunity to write a letter lambasting the conduct of the war under such generals as Buell and McClellan, and was hoping that somebody aggressive would actually take command. On Thursday, October 23rd, Secretary of the Treasury Salmon Chase wrote a letter to President Abraham Lincoln, and this is what he wrote. Under no circumstances whatever can personal violence by one officer to another be passed over without the arrest and trial of the offender, except at the cost of serious detriment to the service and serious injury to the respect due you as Commander-in-Chief. These circumstances, I think, imperatively demand a court-martial. Under the common law, the act is murder. Under our law, manslaughter. Under Bow, a crime. Chase reminded Lincoln of all that Nelson had done to secure Kentucky. Can it be that the affair is to be passed over as an ordinary and insignificant occurrence, like most of our cases, Keith? The next day, October 24th, the murder was discussed at a cabinet meeting. Gideon Wells wrote this in his diary. Some discussion was had in regard to the course which should be pursued towards General J.C. Davis, who killed Major General Nelson. The grand jury, it is reported, have ignored the true bill in the civil case. The question was whether the military ought to take notice of a homicide after the civil authorities declined. Chase and Blair thought the military should. Seward thought the affair might be looked into. I remarked that if the transaction had occurred in the Navy, we should at least have had a court of inquiry. The cabinet took a wait-and-see attitude on the matter, and Lincoln did not make any comment that was recorded. Presidents usually do not speak out about murder cases. There is absolutely no truth whatsoever that Lincoln ever said that if he had had another son, he would have looked a lot like Jefferson C. Davis. The clamor for justice did not go away in Louisville, however. Wells was misinformed. When the civil authorities saw that the Army wasn't going to do anything, they finally took action. Jefferson Davis was indicted for murder, for manslaughter, in the Jefferson County Courthouse on October 27, 1862. He was released on a $5,000 bond, which was put up by Captain Thomas W. Gibson. Governor Morton was ordered to be available for testimony if needed, and this delayed another trip for him to Washington. Davis's attorney was James Speed, who had become President Lincoln's attorney general in December of 1864. Well, Davis was indicted on the wrong charge and in the wrong court. According to Article 9 of the Uniform Code of Military Justice, quote, Any officer or soldier who shall strike his superior officer, or draw or lift up any weapon, or offer any violence against him, being in the execution of his office, on any pretense whatsoever, or shall disobey any lawful command of this superior officer, shall suffer death, or other such punishment as shall, according to the nature of the offense, be inflicted upon him by sentence of court-martial. But that's not what happened. In the Jefferson County Courthouse, on May 24, 1864, after numerous continuances, a final disposition was made in the matter of manslaughter against Jefferson C. Davis for the fatal shooting of General William Nelson. In a moment, the results of that hearing. One can only wonder what the outcome of the Battle of Perryville would have been if Nelson had been in command of his corps and Davis in command of his own division. Now, Gilbert, who was the temporary corps commander, was actually an army captain who had been appointed to corps command by Horatio G. Wright in violation of every edict and norm of the Union Army, because only the president can appoint corps commanders and the Senate has to approve it. This was never done in Gilbert's case. Nonetheless, Captain Gilbert, corps commander, was leading his corps, Nelson's corps, at the Battle of Perryville. And one of those divisions, which was under Robert Mitchell, that would be Davis's division, was heavily engaged in the battle and actually gaining some ground. Carlin's brigade, part of that division, actually made its way into Perryville, captured some Confederate supply trains and a couple of cannon, but could not get reinforcements because Corps Commander Gilbert refused to issue orders and was actually trying to pull them out of the fight until he got rubber stamped by Buell, who didn't even know the battle was being fought, because of one of those acoustic shadows that always affected the Union Army and only affected the Confederate Army one time at Five Forks. Okay. After Perryville, Gilbert returned to his former rank and was assigned to mostly clerical work. Mitchell remained in the Army, but after the Battle of Chickamauga was sent to the districts of Kansas and Nebraska. On October 24th, Major General William S. Rosecrans replaced Buell in command of the Army of the Ohio, which would henceforth be known as the Army of the Cumberland. Rosecrans had defeated Earl Van Dorn at the Battle of Corinth on October 3rd and 4th. This move took him out from under the thumb of U.S. Grant and gave the Western Theater two fighting generals in command of the armies. Buell was out of the war. McClellan followed him on November 7th, replaced by Ambrose E. Burnside. The nature of the war had changed. Jefferson C. Davis remained in the Army, probably because he had one quality lacking in Buell, McClellan, and Gilbert. He was demonstrably able and willing to kill, hopefully more of the enemy than his own side. He eventually rose to the rank of Corps Commander under Sherman with a brevet rank of Major General. But although he remained in the Army for the rest of his life, he never rose any higher. According to one writer, perhaps the administration felt about him that he ought to be thankful for anything, short of hanging. But controversy was never far from his doorstep, as witnessed on December 9, 1864, when he stranded hundreds of freed slaves who were following the army to the mercy of Confederate cavalry at Ebenezer Creek. But Davis was protected for this action by his superiors also. He was apparently made of Teflon. Governor Morton continued in politics and served 2 terms in the U.S. Senate. Today he's honored by a fine monument in front of the Indiana State Capitol in Indianapolis, and he also has a striking marker over his grave in Crown Hill Cemetery in Indianapolis, which is within sight of this fine marker for Jefferson C. Davis, who died here in Chicago at the Palmer House in 1879. But this is the marker for William Nelson. This nondescript marker in the cemetery in his hometown in Maysville, where he was his grave was moved twice, ending up here. After the war, the Kentucky State Legislature refused to appropriate funds for a monument to Nelson. This is a sad memorial to a man who deserves better treatment from history and memory than he has received. After numerous continuances, the case against Davis was dismissed with leave to reinstate. Jefferson C. Davis was free and clear. James Speed's expertise, coupled with Governor Morton's political clout, was enough to suppress the manslaughter indictment. Don Carlos Buell later wrote, Thus, the military authority of the government was abased over the grave of a high officer, who slaughtered by another officer under such circumstances, and as a purely military offense, it had not the character to bring to trial. Although it was later rumored that the governor of Kentucky gave Davis a pardon for this act, there is absolutely no evidence to substantiate this. After the war, when compiling a report of his Civil War service, Jefferson C. Davis referred to the incident only in passing and with his impeccable selective memory. This is what he wrote. General Wright assigned me to duty with Major General Nelson commanding the troops for the defense of Louisville. On the arrival of my division with Buell's army, I assumed command of it. But a few days later, a personal difficulty with General Nelson caused my arrest. And again, General Mitchell assumed command. And that's all he wrote. For the rest of his life, he never once expressed any regret or remorse for what he had done. Of course, it helps to have friends in high places. Nobody has accused President Lincoln of actively interfering in the case. But if you commit a murder, it is not the unluckiest fortune to have a president, a governor, an attorney general, other dignitaries, and a friendly press on your side to give you carte blanche in whatever it is that you do. Of course, we're lucky that in today's day and age, we have, in our elected officials, nobody of this character. We could never doubt that any of them is more than a fine, upstanding person. This has been a true story. Nothing has been changed. Anybody awake? Yes, sir, David.
You mentioned the word Hoosier in there. Are you familiar with Mike Wycliffe's comment, which he said that the word originated because there was a brawl in some tavern in Indiana in the 19th century. Somebody lost an ear, and the tavern keeper picked up the ear and went around asking
who's here. I heard of the War of Jenkins here, but I'm not sure if this is the same thing. We just loathed that story.
Where is that now?
It belongs in private hands. They're actually descendants of Gibson's family, and they live in Goochland, Virginia. Yeah, Nat Hughes, who wrote the biography of Davis, and Gordon Whitney, who was a past president of this group, co-wrote that biography, and they actually went there and got access to Gibson's diary and that pistol. Yeah.
Was Davis considered an abolitionist, or just kind of associated with
him? He was in no way, shape, or form considered an abolitionist. He was all too happy to cut that bridge at Ebenezer Creek.
But Morton was.
Morton was a rabid abolitionist.
So it was just that Indiana
connection. Yeah. And actually, Buell complained constantly that Morton seemed to think that once these Indiana regiments were raised and sworn into the service, that they still belonged to him, and that he had some say in where they were assigned or what duties they could perform, but he just made himself a pest. I mean, you can imagine having a politician trying to run anything, let alone an army, is not a good idea.
Do you think that Paul Nelson's naval experience might have put him in a bad place, you know, where Sherman's saying he was eventually going to run into trouble?
Well, you know, if you look at the naval tradition, quarterdeck manners are not dining room manners, especially not in under fire. And Nelson was a little deafened by some of the naval conflict that he had been in, so that may have had something to do with it. Not much. But, you know, Nelson was a big bull. I mean, he's a big guy. And he was used to getting his way one way or the other. He's also in command. Now, perhaps Davis, because of his physical size, had always been picked on. So he's a little, you know, the little kid that the big bullies are always picking on his whole life. He actually witnessed a duel during the Mexican War where his commander called out a commander and they fought a duel. And Gibson was notorious dueler. He actually lost his job in the Navy for doing that. So Davis is a little firecracker, not this mild-mannered man. You know, when he got into the phone, he turned into the Hulk. He was you wouldn't want to mess with him in a dark alley. So Davis up against Nelson. Nelson, Davis doesn't, is a regular Army guy all the way. Here's this interloper. Now Davis can't get into West Point because his congressman had already appointed somebody else, and they tried to finagle something to get in that appointment, but the other guy said, hell no, I'm going. And so Davis got commissioned directly into the ranks, but now he's a jump up. So he doesn't have the status of a West Point degree that the other officers do. He's like, oh, you know, you're not really one of us. So he's still an outsider. Now he's being commanded by a naval guy. And that's not even his regular commander, because he's not with his division. So here's basically, you got another division commander who's just about to become a corps commander. They're the same rank. Nelson predates him, but, I'm not going to listen to you. And they just have that tension. And when you work for somebody you don't respect, that tension is apparent. Some of us in this room know what that feels like. But
I'm glad to see you didn't need any sneaky lawyer tricks to get out of this. So.
No, it was pretty open and shut case.
It wasn't. But did he have any family or anybody who spoke? I mean, Nelson, did he have any family or anybody who spoke up for him? Or?
Nelson's brother, Tom, the one that moved to Indiana, was a staunch Republican, and he rose in. He was a big shot in Indiana politics. He had another brother that was in the Army. His sister, his parents both died before the war. He was never married. But he had Chase, and he had Lincoln, and you know he had a lot of people in Kentucky were staunch supporters of Nelson. If you read the newspapers, the Indianapolis newspapers are saying, oh, well, Nelson deserved what was going. Poor Jeff Davis was bullied by this tyrant, and he had no choice. He got his honors besmirched in public. Very few accounts showed that Davis was the provocateur that started this whole thing. And so he's unjust. No matter what happened, it's his fault thereafter. Nelson, you know, overreacted by slapping him, perhaps, but that's his junior officer. That guy's got to do what he's told, and he's got no business calling out a subordinate's got no business calling out a superior in public for a private matter that he should have taken official action up the chain of command a week before.
Even at 26th Street, I don't think that's justifiable.
No, it's no, not even in Cook County.
No, shooting an unknown man.
Which is why I think they fought so hard for it not to go to trial.
Okay, why did Morton dissolve the legislature in Indiana?
Because they were pro-Confederate almost. He was afraid they were going to take Indiana out of the war. And so rather than have that happen, he just didn't call them in a session. Yates did the same thing in Illinois. Yeah. Disbanded the legislature for a summer during the same period of time. And then he took it upon himself to pay the state debt by borrowing from the government, which had never been done before. Too bad that was the president's letter. Yeah.
Given his notoriety, Davis's, one would think that they would have sort of shuffled him off somewhere to the Sioux Uprising or wherever, but yet he played a pretty prominent role, I believe, throughout the rest of the war and the campaigns of the Army to cover. Is there any good explanation for that?
Well, he's a fighting general. And in an army, at a time in the war when you're looking for fighting generals, they're hard to find. There's a handful of them that rise to division and corps command. Most of the ones that rise to corps command either go to Army command or get killed or get shuffled off in the redistribution of rank after every campaign. Davis was a fighter. Again, he was in the West and he was protected by a crew of people that respected him. Sherman liked him. Rosecrans was able to put up with him. However, Davis's subordinates, William B. Carlin and Hans Haig, they despised him. They wrote letters to Rosecrans asking to have Davis removed from command or to be transferred out from under him after the Battle of Stones River. They despised him. So that controversy kind of never went away. But Davis he was just a child of fortune.
Why did they despise him?
Carlin hated him because during the opening shots of the Stones River campaign, Davis issued orders without going through Carlin to units in Carlin's brigade basically they charged into an artillery position and got decimated. And Haig and Carlin both despised him for that. And they accused him of doing it on purpose. And then at Stones River, that's when they write that letter. Then at Chickamauga, Davis is sending Carlin's brigade into harm's way, and Carlin's right at the breakthrough point at Stones River when his brigade gets routed, and he's actually holding on just long enough for Sheridan to take up position in those rock outcroppings. Carlin gets driven away. Sheridan gains his reputation because of Carlin's sacrifice. Then at Chickamauga, when Thomas Wood's division gets pulled out of line, guess whose troops are right there? It's Davis's division, Carlin's brigade on the flank that's about to get hit by Longstreet's corps. Davis rides away, Carlin stays out of the field, rallies his brigade, finds Phil Sheridan, and they go back to battle. Davis is nowhere to be seen. After that battle, Carlin gets his own division, and he's out from under Davis until the march to the sea. Well, thank you very much.